So I'm going to put a little bit of a blanket up under my rumpus because having been in weightlifting class and having worked on the hip flexors and the quads, all of this is going to want to pull up and in. It's going to be like, ah! So the way to outsmart that is to put the hips on, let the legs roll off, and then it'll pull the tailbone out behind us. And we'll sit down and in as everybody gets prepared. I mean, you know, it's not like we have to end right at 11. We're going to, you know, if y'all need to check out, you'll check out. But otherwise, I'm going to run class for an hour. It's going to be good. We're going to start to slow the breath. Start to move from outside to inside. And that's a concept that I didn't understand for probably a decade of doing yoga. What do you mean move from outside to inside? And what I've come to learn is that normal human psychology, we look outside for what represents or what reflects our own emotions. So if I'm looking for happiness, I'm looking out there for what reflects my happiness. If I am angry, I look out there and I see what reflects my anger. So if you'll notice on days that you're angry and you get in traffic, the traffic is everybody else's fault. On the days that you're like totally chill with yourself, you can get in traffic and be like, well, this is just the way life is. So after about, no, it was more than 10 years, probably 15 years, I finally started to really get that's outside, and it's what I see with my eyes and experience through my vision and my hearing and my other senses. So then with yoga, we learn to go inside and start to look around and see where the happy is on the inside. Ooh, we got a shift card. So see if this makes any sense. Under a microscope, each grain of sand is marvelously unique in color and form, telling a story of diverse origins. A remnant of shell, a particle of rock, the fine remains of a gemstone, they all lay side by side with tiny reminders from countless other sources. Wind and water bring the dust of the world together to blanket Earth's deserts, shorelines, and riverbeds. As tides turn, storms rage, and airstreams change, beaches grow and deplete, dunes disappear and reform, and riverbanks churn into the ocean. Sand is constantly shifting in response to its surroundings. All manner of creatures make their home in the sand, where quick burrows provide effective, if temporary, refuge from danger. In the face of upheaval, we can rush for cover or comfort in people, opinions, or circumstances before we fully assess what is being offered. In a flurry, we might cherry-pick data or pick bits of this and pieces of that to get us through. And that is completely fine. But when things don't hold up, be mindful that the energy expended rebuilding sand forts could be invested in more solid fortitude. So breathe that in. See if you can find somewhere inside where you've built sand forts and this whole process of quarantining is blowing those sand forts away. And as you start to kind of seek into those places, it could be a little uncomfortable. We don't want to maybe go to the nth of it unless you're ready for today. We're going to start moving the torso around in circles so as to stir. So currents in the water, they stir. The moon moves the rivers. The rivers rise up the banks. And when the waters recede because the moon pulls them back, it takes that sediment out into the ocean with it. Well, the thing is when I was a kid, I grew up on the beach, and our favorite thing to do was go to the beach when the sandbars were exposed. They were awesome because you'd have that little ankle deep bit of water that you could run across, and then you could go out and you could kind of play king of the mountain because there was this little island that would show up sometimes. Pause, go in the other direction. And a lot of times on that little sandbank would be sand dollars. And they wouldn't be dead sand dollars because the water had just exposed them. So we would pick up the live sand dollars and fling them like frisbees back out further into the water. Or there would be starfish or other types of shells and that kind of thing. But it was just like magic because sometimes we'd go to the beach and the sandbars would be there, and other times they wouldn't. And as a little kid, we didn't necessarily understand tides. Now, pause with the back arched. Pull the ribs in. Drop the chin down. And so what the card is saying is that we all have sandcastles on the inside. We all have sandbars. We all have collections of sediment that we also call home. Breathing in. Notice it's shallow. Now tip forward, expose the belly to the floor, little bit of pressure in the hands so that the collarbones can then be pulled even further forward. Now breathe in. Feel the expansiveness. And then pull right back up through neutral. Right hand slides out, left arm sweeps out and over. So if we look inside, what is it that sometimes is an exposed sandbar? And I know that, oh my God, right now I've got parts of my personality that I thought were gone. And because we're all squished into this situation, those pieces are coming back out because the sand that I built up around them is eroding. So I'm having to like really look at the diamonds and rough. Breathe in, breathe out, lift up, sweep over. Well, the other thing about growing up out at the beach or near the beach, because as I got older, of course, we couldn't afford to live at the beach because my God, we moved further in town. And then Hurricane Hugo happened and I grew up in Charleston. And Hurricane Hugo shut everything down for 30 days, just like we're in right now, except there was no power and no food and no nothing. And we had stayed in town. Breathe in, breathe out, reach all the way up. Bring all of the energy from the base of the spine right up into the crown of the head and shoot it up out of the crown of the head and cup the hands around it as if you were just like a giant lamppost. And just hold there for a moment. And then with little micro movements, move the right hand a little further up. Big breath. And then micro movement settles it back down. And then left hand, micro movement, moves up. And then it moves back down. So just when the body thinks I'm done, I'm at my edge, wait a minute, right hand moves up. Oh, there's more space. So like with Hurricane Hugo, as I put my hand down and I lift my left hand up, there were all kinds of changes that came along, and it was, I mean, we all turned into victims. I mean, houses were leaking, houses were gone, you know, people's cars were trashed, lives were lost, the whole situation. Now let the arms spread open, big circles out here. Breathe into the chest, run the thumbs slightly behind you, touch the shoulder blades together. Lift the sternal space, breathe right into that chest, and then sweep the fingers together, cupping that beach ball in front of you, arching the neck down, and then open the thumbs back. And just open the chest, holding there. And then when you think you've hit your edge, move the thumbs back another micro inch. Feel the pulling together of the shoulder blades. And then release. So just like with Hugo, after 30 days, everything took a big deep breath. Everything relaxed. Breathe in, thumbs reach back one more time. Until it did, it was micro movements. We got a shipment of toilet paper. Whoa, you know, the water trucks came in. Thumbs reach back a little more. That's the micro movement. Shipments of generators came in. Oh, we can take hot showers. And then power was restored. And everything took a deep breath. Bring those hands together. Arch down and in. Breathe it in. Breathe it out. Hands reach down for the tops of the thighs. The head stays bowed forward. And then slowly let the back round and tip and tip and tip. If you need to move the legs, move the legs. But roll down until the body finds a stopping place. Just crumple in on yourself. So as if you were a sandcastle that a child left behind on the beach. In the child's mind, the sandcastle is still there. It'll always be there. And then in reality, the wind and the waves and mischievous people came along and wiped it away. So slide your right hand further forward. Reach through the armpit. Breathe in. Bring in some of that eroding wind into the lungs. And then slide that hand back. Settle. And then left hand, the winds begin to pick up on the beach. We breathe more deeply. And then that hand slides back. And now the tide rises. The tide rises and both hands sweep forward. The waves start to roll in. And then the ultimate erosion happens. The waves break over the sandcastle. And on our next breath in, we slide up, sliding our hands across our mats, sweeping away the sandcastle. Shoulders roll up and back. Heads lift. And full breath. And the beauty about the waves and the rising tides is it deposits starfish and seashells and sea glass and all the other things that we find that we wouldn't have found unless the tides rose, unless the storms came. Breathe it in. Breathe it out. Move your cushion if you've got one underneath you. Lean back into your forearms. Oh, go move my mic back. There we go. Nothing quite so surprising as rolling back on a mic pack. Right leg is going to rise. Left foot plants. Collarbones lift so that you've got a little mini Matsyasana going on back there in the spine, a little fish posture. And we're going to take this heel, press it forward, extend that leg, and then pull it back and in. Two more times, press and extend. One more time, press and extend. Now this time we're going to press and extend. Press the left foot down, press the forearms down. Lift the tush a micro inch or two. Breathe it in. Breathe it out. Put it down. Pull that knee toward the nose. Bow the head in toward it. Inhale. Exhale. Put that foot down. Now, if it would feel good to lay your head back, do so. If you've had any cervical issues, though, keep it right here at neutral or maybe roll onto your back, expose the throat space, breathe some eroding air in, and as you exhale, lift the head, left leg lifts shin parallel to the floor at first, and then press the heel out, and then pull it in, extend the leg, and pull it in, extend the leg, pull in. This time the extension holds. We press down into the foot. We press down. Holy smokes, I can almost not do it on this side. Breathing in, breathing out, tush lands. Knee pulls in. We try to touch the forehead. Breathing in, breathing out. Head goes to neutral. Roll onto your spine. Let your head land on the floor, palms face up. Roll your head from side to side. All right. So the nose rolls up toward the ceiling, right ankle on top of left thigh. We're going to either leave that there if you've got hip issues going on, or else we're going to pick that left shin up until it's parallel to the floor. Hands sweep up toward the ceiling, and we are going to erode the midsection. Head pulls up, fingertips lift up. So the fingertips drive straight up. We lift up and away from the floor, and we hold that other leg out so that we're just eroding. We're asking our cells to erode and eat up the sugars and the fat cells. We're asking the tension that we're creating in the body to erode any excess energy out of the body, so that then the nervous system is left a blank slate. Breathe in, breathe out, fingertips just behind the ears, head and shoulders roll down, left foot lands on the floor for just a moment. Breathing in, breathing out, right hand sweeps out 90 degrees from the shoulder, and then we're gonna pick that left elbow up. We're gonna bring that right knee toward the left elbow and just hold. It's kind of like Pilates, but frozen. Two more breaths. One more. And then release to the floor, both arms out in T position. And we're going to roll this right thigh toward the floor. Now, if it's too much to have the right heel hooked on the left thigh, then release and just stack one knee on top of the other. Otherwise, we just hold. So the biggest thing about Hurricane Hugo wasn't, well, for us, I was 13 and we got out of school for 30 days. It was magic. The other thing was, is I was stuck in the house with a bunch of people they didn't necessarily like because I was a teenager. But it was the stuff that was the test of time. It was a long time before we were allowed to go out to the beaches again because the amount of debris that was built up on the beaches and that was still floating in the water. I mean, houses were out floating in the water out there. And when we finally went back out to the beach, the sandbars were gone. Those happy, happy sandbars I'd played on for years, decades when I was younger, when I was younger. At 13, I had 10 beautiful years of memories of these sandbars, and I waited. The tide went out. The sandbars never were there. So tide would come back in. The tide would go back out the next trip out. The sandbars were gone. Breathe in, lift those legs back up, place the right foot down, exchange with the left. That right shin comes up parallel to the floor, hands stretch up toward the ceiling, and then reach and lift and reach and lift and reach and lift and roll. So the big thing is it's like there are things that this whole process are going to shift within us. And those shifts, some of them we're not even going to notice for a year or 6 months. Some of the things is it's moving entire sandbars And it's exposing what's underneath, like my personality quirks. Breathe in, roll down fingertips behind the ears. Big breath in. Put that right foot down. Left arm extends out into T position. The left knee pulls in. The right elbow kisses it if it can. And we just hold. So yoga has that as part of its process too. Yoga erodes. You know, you kind of have these little flashes of images, or the teacher will say something and you're like, whoa, I didn't even know I still, you know, felt that. Or, you know, oh, there was that memory. I'd forgotten about that for 40 years. Roll back down, breathe in, breathe out, arms in T position. Left thigh drops toward the floor if you can pull that much of a full twist. If not, undo the whole process and just stack the legs. But as I've morphed my own yoga home practice into more of a yoga meditation practice, the erosion is happening more rapidly. So if you don't have a meditation practice and you want to dig for diamonds, might I suggest you add some meditation? Because now is a beautiful time to shift. Next time you breathe in, the knees come up. Reach those legs up and out at, 25, 35, 45 degrees. Hands reach up toward the ceiling. Heels reach, hands reach straight up. The legs are falling partially away. Breathe it in. Breathe it out. Fall out. Dead bug posture. The legs go wide. The arms go wide. And if you need to shake, shake it out. Dead bug, or dying bug. And then pause. Oh, the rain took effect. And then bring the legs back together, fingertips behind the head, pull up just for one more breath. And then pull the knees into the chest, let the head and shoulders rest, squish those thighs into the belly, roll the head from side to side to make sure no tension has taken hold. And take a giant shifting breath. What needs to shift for you? We got into a very long discussion last night about victimhood. After what happened yesterday, feet go straight up, arms out into T. So victimhood showed up yesterday. There was nothing we could do about what happened during yoga yesterday. And we were very upset. Breathing in, breathing out, hands slide up to the sides of the thighs, slide up to the knees, slide up to the ankles, slide up to the big toes. If the fingers can just touch the toes, just touch. There's a great desire to latch on to the toes. So if you need a greater stretch, latch onto the toes and pull the legs over the top of the body. Beautiful. Roll back into plow posture if you want to. But otherwise, we're still in this midsection, eroding feelings, eroding ego structure. Breathe in. Breathe out, slide it down. If you are a shoulder stand person, before you go into it, hug the knees into the chest, check the back of the neck, roll the head from side to side a couple of times. And if you decide that you want to go into a shoulder stand, I'm not going to say no, but I can't be there to support you or help you. If you want to go into a bridge posture with me, the feet land right behind the sits bones or a little wider. Ankles are right under knees, hands on either side of the hips. Shoulder blades squeeze together in the back, and then the pelvis rises. And use the breath. Use the breath like true north. It is the sextant that is built within us. It's the compass.
The breath is what don't lie. It's not the hips don't lie, it's the breath. Because when most of us are pushed to our edge, our breath shortens and our jaws clench. And most of us are at an age where we know that when we're pushed, if we just push that deep breath through, it can have the power to break up the energy that is building around whatever the circumstance is. So the next time you're ready, take a deep breath. And if your hips are up, use that deep breath to release the tension and then let the knees swish swash from side to side. So I challenge thee, what are the eroding sand castles right now? And because it's a castle, it has like a dungeon or it has a basement, and there is a hidden treasure down there. So I've just now put a magic hidden treasure in the bottom of your eroding sand castle. So if you want your hidden treasure, you got to go dig. Let the legs fall off to one side and hold, doesn't matter which way. Breathing in, breathing out, up and over to the other side. Nice shifting breath. And then one more time, knees come to stand, feet either right behind the tush, or if you did a shoulder stand, and this time you want to do a plow posture, that's a shoulder stand, but with the feet dropped over the top of the body and tucked in behind the head back there. If you're going to do bridge with me, plant those feet, lift those hips, roll those shoulder blades together. If you need an example, Ori's now flipped up and back. Beautiful. And no matter what we do, we keep that jaw tucked into the collarbones. Reaching with the crown of the head to elongate that cervical spine. We squeeze the glutes. We press through the feet. We find that magical ball that rolls up between our shoulder blades. We lift our heart spaces a little more and bridge. Breathe in. Breathe out, and wherever you are, slowly roll everything down, stretch everything out nice and long on the floor. And just give yourself three breaths. Erode the nervous system. And on your next breath, we're going to decide the best way for us to make it onto our bellies. I'm going to tuck my battery pack back in. Roll onto your belly. Oh, yeah. See. There's nothing quite like second and third chakra work. Big toes come together. Hands slide up underneath let's put the elbows underneath the shoulders, the hands slide, and just look down at the thumbs and make sure that the thumbs are pointing toward each other. If it hurts to roll the palms down into the floor, then pinky side comes down onto the floor. But the palms press down, the big toes come together, and then there's going to be kind of a push me, pull you. You're going to use the pull of the forearms to lengthen the belly space and pull the belly button until, instead of being round, if you have an outie, you would want it to be pulled and stretched until it was level. If you've got an innie, you would want it to go from a big, like that big face into and y'all know what I mean. So make your belly button into a different shape. Breathe in. Breathe out. And then let the head hang heavy, sagging between the upper arms. And then slowly let the head come up in line with the spine. Press the palms of the hand. Press the forearms.
extend the sternum forward into your fullest expression of Sphinx posture. And because you're in your own house, you're allowed to stick your tongue out and have some lion breaths. Breathing in. Tongue comes out. Next one, breathe in. Tongue comes out. And then fingertips come together, forehead lays down on the back of the hands. Lion posture isn't something I pull out in the middle of class very often with seniors. Not if I want to see seniors again. Beautiful. All right. So we're going to pick the back of the head up. We're going to take the arms, sweep them out to the side, put a cupcake under each palm, toes point behind you, kneecaps lift so that the tops of the feet press down into the floor, and then slide your fingertips toward you about 3 inches, and then press down and try to lift until you can get the rib points off the floor. Now the goal here is squeeze the inner thighs together, squeeze and squeeze and squeeze and squeeze and squeeze, lift and lift and lift and lift, and then slowly roll about halfway down. Take a big deep breath because we're going to morph this into something else. Breathing in, breathing out. If the fingers are arthritic and they don't feel good, put the palms and the hands on the floor. We're going to press, we're going to lift, we're going to reach through the back of the head. Inner thighs are going to squeeze and squeeze and squeeze and squeeze. Tops of the feet are going to press down, and then lift the hands. So we want to have that maximum rise and that maximum squeeze from the back end so that we can have as little pressure on the rib points as possible. Inhale, exhale, hands sweep up under the forehead, head turns the other way, or forehead straight down. Beautiful. Left hand stays where it is. Forehead turns down into the back of the hand. Right hand sweeps straight forward, thumb side up, pinky side down, inner thighs touching. All right. So we're going to take that left leg and we're going to lift it off the floor. And for some of us, it might not lift very high. The biggest thing that we want to pay attention to is that the right leg isn't pushing down, because that's going to roll the right hip up off the floor. We want the left leg to lift of its own volition. Then we're going to let the head rise. We're going to establish some strength through the chest wall by pressing the left arm down a little bit, and then the right arm is going to rise. So we have support, but just like we talked about in the last class, this is a really funky muscle set up here at the top of the shoulder. So there may be weakness here, only because we need to find strength here, or maybe because there's imbalance. So we're going to just check it all out and see if we can find the balance space. One more breath. Leg lowers, hands tucks in, forehead drops back down. Now, core work tends to erode things more quickly than some of the other postures, because some of the other postures are a lot more fun and we like to be entertained. Core work is very focused, and its erosion factor is kind of like the difference between a light breeze and a sandblaster. All right, right hand stays where it is. Left hand slides forward, pinky side down, thumb side up. Inner thighs touching at first. Pubic bone presses into the floor, and then the right leg slides up. Now the left leg has nothing to do, but it's going to want to help. The head slowly lifts up and away. You can either stay here, find support in the chest wall by pressing that right arm down, and then if it works for you, lift that left arm. Now, if your hand is only hovering like a little bit off the floor, or your fingertips are having to come down on the floor, that's actually extremely normal with this shoulder muscle set. Reach back through those right toes. Make sure that that left leg doesn't have anything to do.
Breathing in. Breathing out. Stack hands, lower the leg, and let the head rest. Big toes come together. Inner thighs pressing. And then slowly let both legs rise. Toes pointed right at the wall behind you. Big toes touching, inner thighs pressing together. Head just resting. The upper body has nothing to do, but you'll notice like series of twitches will go on because your muscles are going to go, no, let me help. No, let me help. No, let me help. I just tell those muscles, put a sock in it. Just let that low back and those glutes and hams do what they need to do. Breathing in. On the breath out, erode the posture. Send a wave over it. Let everything melt. And just impersonate a flattened sandcastle. The next breath in, big toes come to touch, inner thighs press. The forehead turns down, the hands slide toward the collarbones just a little. We press down so that we can release the rib points from the floor for just a moment. Pubic bone presses down and in. I've got a little squeeze down there, a little smile down there at the base of the tailbone. And then stretch the belly button, make it make that face. And then put the rib points down. And if you feel safe and comfortable, lift the hands right up under the chin for the professional photo. That's it. That's what I'm talking about. Book cover photo right here. Our book entitled Eroded Sandcastles and the Treasure Beneath. Breathing it in. Struggle the struggle. Sometimes we need to struggle safely and then roll everything down. Feel the nervous system release. Hands plant underneath the shoulders. Lift up and back. Stretch it into a puppy. Hips stay high. Arms reach forward. If you want to go into a downward facing dog, because that would be safe and fun for you to do, do that instead. Have your downward facing dog moment or puppy moment. Breathing in. Out. And then slide the hands in, lift up into tabletop. Pull my shirt down, get decent. Hands plant right underneath the shoulders. Hips wag just a moment, just so you can find the comfort zone for the knees. Make sure you pad up the knees if you need to. Head is in line with the spine, belly button pulled in. Then the first thing we're going to do is move that left thumb a little closer to the right thumb. Knees are going to widen a little. And then let that right arm reach up. Breathe in. Breathe out. Slide the fingertips underneath. Let the shoulder kiss the floor. And then take it straight back up. So we're not holding that needle. We're lifting, twisting, wringing out that core space, ringing through second and third chakras. We're eroding. Yes! We're shifting the dunes. Now, the goal is not to shift the sand dune from one pile of garbage to the other. It's to sweep the dunes away completely. One more time, let that shoulder come and settle on the floor. Let the ears settle and just hold there a moment. See, that's what I figured out I've done. I've shifted entire deserts, but I shifted it from one garbage pile to another. So then the dunes got swept to the other garbage pile again. Oh my God. Next time you breathe in, press back into that left hand, right fingertip, reach up, breathe, and then put that hand down. Yep, having a wardrobe malfunction. All right. Right fingertips move toward left, and here we go. Opposite side, left fingertips reach up. Roll all the way down. Squeeze it out, my loves. Squeeze it. Squeeze it, reach it, reach it, reach it, and squeeze it. Oh, yeah, it's Cinco de Mayo. Squeeze those limes. Sweep it up. That's what I'm talking about. One more time, sweep it up. This time, let that shoulder come down and kiss the earth. Ear lands, modicum of comfort. If this particular posture is hard, it's either probably because of body parts that don't want to play along because they're sore, or because we've got stuck energy. And it can be stuck belly energy or stuck spine energy. It could also be stuck neck energy. So there could be a truth trying to work its way out. Breathe it in. Breathe it out. Press down into that right hand. Sweep that left hand all the way up. Beautiful. That left hand comes down. The knees walk a little closer together, but that right foot is going to stretch forward. And we're going to walk the hands forward and stretch the right foot forward and walk the hands forward and stretch the right foot forward until we're really stretched into lizard posture. So the hips come way down. Here, I'll turn sideways. There we go. So we're really stretched through the groin space. Gorgeous. So make sure that the wrists and the fingertips and whatnot are fairly comfortable. Then you're going to walk your left hand a little further out. Shift more toward the left hand and let that right arm sweep up. So giant twist. Yep. Right hand reaches way up. That left hip sweeps down. Modify this in all the ways, but you're really stretched and really twisted. If you want to drop that right hand behind the back, you could drop it behind the back to add just a little more funk to the posture. Breathe it in. Breathe it out, sweep the right fingertips back up. Hand comes down, left hand walks back in a little. All right, if you wanna put the forearms on the floor, put the forearms on the floor. Now you're gonna be really stretched out. For any of you that have the capability of doing a split, you're welcome to move into split here. Yes, I heard a communal chuckle, but I do offer. I mean, breathing it in, breathing it out, and then back up on the hands. If you're stretched out, start to walk it back together. Mind that left hip flexor. Come down onto the forearms. Keep the hips high. Stack the hands, hot potato, and just leave the hips up. Let the belly just hang loose. No judgment here, not even on yourself. Gorgeous. All right. Second verse, same as the first. Hands come down. I'm going to turn the opposite way. All right. Walk that left foot forward. Way forward. Foot forward, hand forward, foot forward, hands forward, until you really stretch through groin space. Oh, yeah. That's what I'm talking about. Find some breath here. That right hip flexor for most of us are going to be right-handed. So that right hip flexor for most of us is going to be fairly tight. Walk that right hand a little further out and then start the twist.
if you need to come down onto forearms, or if this hand doesn't want to play along, you could put the forearm on top of a pillow or something, or just modify and just don't do this bit. If the hand needs to bend and reach behind the back, then reach. Find all the stretch, all the twist, squeeze it out, and then reach back up. Hand, legs, right hand moves in, find the shins. It's a good thing Ori can't do a split, or not that I know of. She might try, because then she would like crack my head like a walnut. She has the opportunity to smash my head like a grape right now. I didn't realize how close I was to her. Breathe it in. Breathe it out. If you want to stretch out in the split, stretch out in the split. One more big breath. And then bring it back up and in. Walking it all back together. Hips stay high. Forearms come down. Stack the hands. Let the groin relax. All right. We get to bump over onto the back. So hands, hip, roll. Beautiful. Oh, that's what I'm talking about. Arms out into T position, knees tucked in. If you want to take a more complicated twist and you want to do like an eagle wrap twist off to the right, you're welcome to. I'm just going to keep my knees stacked and drop my knees to the right. And then play with the head. So if we've got second and third chakras involved here, and for folks that don't know a lot about chakras, yes, it could be hocus pocus. I'm a realist. Yes, there's also quantum energy out there that we do not tap into. Yes, the soul also exists. So therefore, why couldn't we have energy centers in our body? So second and third chakra, second chakra is where our feelings are. It's my right to feel. It's my right to be angry when I need to be angry. It's my right to be happy when I need to be happy. And with most people right now, we don't give ourselves the right to feel, because we might feel disappointed or feel injustice, or we're going to feel anger. And things could be boiling there that could be decades and decades old. And then the third chakra is what they call the ego space. But it's not ego in a bad way. Well, it could be ego in a bad way. Most of us, however, suffer from ego space that is too small and underfed. When somebody says, you know what, I'm proud of you, we go, oh, no, it's okay. No. You know, we're taught to be overly humble. Next time you breathe in, roll the knees up. Let the low back just settle a moment. But those two spaces go hand in hand, because if I've replaced my feeling space with ego space of being cocky, or, you know, all those things that go with yucky egos. Legs go to the left. Whoop. Then one chakra overshadows the other. Both go with gut issues, though. Both go with IBS or diarrhea or chronic constipation. Most people I know are chronically constipated. So if I've got solar plexus issues, if I've got ego issues, then I'm going to go, and I'm not going to feed myself properly, and I'm not going to drink enough water, and I'm going to exercise more than you, and I'm going to have a bigger house than you, and I'm going to drive a better car, and we know those people. So constipation, acid reflux, stomach ulcers, pancreas, gallbladder, all those things. The second chakra and our feeling issues, that's where our lower bowel symptoms come in. Those are where our reproductive issues can begin with women. Next time you breathe in, let those knees come back up center. Cross the right ankle on top of the left thigh, reach through, grab the back of the left thigh, and just give yourself a little figure four hug. And breathe into the belly space. Concentrate on letting the breath erode the belly space. And as it erodes through that belly energy, ask for the shift. What is it that could be wiped away so that I could look at it really clearly through fresh eyes? And maybe find some acceptance. That's a big thing we've been talking about in the house a lot. Acceptance. Release, switch legs, pull it in, hug yourself because I can't hug you. Feel what's present. Notice if you can find acceptance for it. Acceptance will cause the shift because whatever the victimization is or whatever the anger is or the sadness is, if I can find acceptance for it, I can then find gratitude for it. Gratitude transmutes all energy. Breathe it in. Exhale it out. And then find your Shavasana space. Stack yourself up under your knees. Let your body stretch. If you're having sinus issues, you might want to sit up. Just find some comfort. Give yourself permission. What have you seen of yourself lately that maybe you don't like? There's a whole nother layer of feelings in the world. It's not just how do I feel about something. It's, do I like the way I feel about something? It's like, it's an up-leveling of the game. I feel, okay, I feel. Ooh, the next layer. The next layer is what erodes it. That's where the shift happens. Do I like the way I feel about how I feel? Ooh, Mufasa. So if you can identify something like that, just really quickly, I don't like the way I feel about how I feel about blah. Take a deep breath on it. Breathe it out. And then the next breath is a breath of shift. Breathe into the way I feel about the way I feel. Send it away. And notice if you can identify some gratitude there somehow, some way. The gratitude is the rain and the wind and the tide. And just breathe.
So hum. 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 Hum sa. So hum. Hum sa. So hum, so hum, so hum, so hum, so hum, so hum. So hum, so hum, so hum, so hum, so hum, so hum, so so hum, hum, so
biggest breath in, deepest sigh out.
We are perfect. We have to figure out how to know it, how to feel it, how to breathe it, how to live it. We are perfect. If you need to wiggle around, move around on that, then do so. Three breaths and a whole new day begins. Belly, ribs, and collarbones. Let these be shifting sounds. If you need to yell, yell. If you need to sigh, sigh. If humming works, then hum. Do what you need to do. Let it shift. Breathe into the belly. Breathe into the ribs. Oh, oh. I'm going cosmic hollow. I'm going to move the microphone. Breathe it in. Oh, oh. You guys are like magic to my soul. Thank you, Ori. Thank you, you guys. I see you.